to Claremont, Indiana, as we get ready for the Scott Get Geared Up 200 from Lucas Oil Raceway. Guys, we have to keep our eye on starting tonight in the third spot, 59-year-old Ken Schrader. Don't be fooled by his age. Kenny has already raced in over 50 races this season in his dirt modified and has 17 career wins in the ARCA Racing Series. Our most recent winner is points leader Mason Mitchell. Momentum could propel him to career win number two tonight. But it was 17-year-old Brandon Jones who broke the track record earlier and has a perfect record in the ARCA Racing Series. His only other start ended in victory lane at Winchester. It looks as though we're going to have another great points battle. He's going to see the checkered flag for the first time. Mason Mitchell wins in the ARCA Racing Series.
Grant Enfinger is your winner tonight at the Altoona 250. Frank Kimmel back in the hunt for a championship once again.
The checkered flag will fly. Tom Hessard wins at Talladega.
Lucas Oil Raceway is the side of this one. Short track racing for the ARCA Racing Series.
This racetrack is almost 7/10 of a mile, but the straightaways are really short and the corners are really long. The action is so severe here, you don't want to miss a second.
Oh, how about the 88? Our leader into the wall. A little contact made there. Oh, we've got some problems right in front of our leader. Short track racing from Lucas Oil Raceway.
200 laps in front of us in the Scott Get Geared Up 200 for the ARCA Racing Series. It's race number 12. For the ARCA Racing Series on the season. A gorgeous evening for racing. 71 degrees, just a slight breeze, and partly cloudy skies overhead.
Hello, everyone. Rick Allen and Phil Parsons back with you. As we get ready for this, the 12th race, we've got to look back on the last race. Mason Mitchell really put on a show, getting his first ever win at Chicagoland.
He really did. He'd been so close to 2 second-place finishes last year, 4 second-place finishes this year. That young man was on a mission, and he got by Justin Boston, and that was the pass for the win late in the race. He got to victory lane, and I believe they're going to come in bunches now. Consistency is what this young man has. He's had 20 top 10 finishes in a row dating back to last year.
His numbers are very impressive. Obviously, a victory lane visit for Mason Mitchell is what he's been looking for, but so many close calls for that young man, but he does finally get it done.
Wipe that all away. He's got to win now.
So we come from Chicagoland, an intermediate racetrack, and come now to a short track. How much different will the racing be tonight?
It's going to be really different. They're going to be beating and banging. They're going to be fighting for space all over this racetrack. We've had 2 races here in the last 24 hours, and they had a last lap pass in both of them. Maybe the same tonight.
Let's get things underway. We go trackside for today's pre-race ceremonies.
Now we ask that you all rise, remove your caps and hats, and remain standing in honor of this great country in which we live, this free country. Here to present the invocation for tonight's big show, ARCA chaplain from Charlotte, North Carolina, Caleb Higgins.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for this wonderful day and this beautiful creation that you've created for us. Father, we thank you for our wonderful fans and our officials and our teams. Lord, we ask that this race will be great for our fans. Lord, we ask that you be with everyone and protect them today. In Jesus' name, amen.
And if you would remain standing, please. Now, we are proud to present the star of the feature film, The Identical, in theaters September 5th, here to perform the live rendition of our national anthem, Blake Rain.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave.
Drivers are strapped in. We're ready to go 200 laps from Lucas Oil Raceway. The engine will be fired next. Welcome back. Under the lights for short track racing for the ARCA Racing Series from Lucas Oil Raceway in the Scott Get Geared Up 200. Earlier today, qualifying took place. Menards full award winner, presented by Ansell, was Brandon Jones, breaking the track record. That young man will bring the field to the green flag in just a few moments. Let's go trackside to Jim Trado.
Rick, one driver that's here racing for a championship has a brand new opportunity. The name on the hood, Motor Honey's the same. The number 90's on the side of the car, but it's all changed for Grant Enfinger. This week, as of last night, they announced it. He is with a new team this week. Sitting second in the points, just 35 out, Grant Enfinger has moved over to GMS Racing, taking over this ride for the rest of the season in this number 90 Allegiant Chevrolet. It's a big deal back here in 15th for that team to move forward tonight. Let's go to the head of the grid, speaking of moving forward, to Wendy Venturini.
One race, one win. That is the ARCA Series record for this guy, Brandon Jones, who will start from the pole for Turner Scott Motorsports. It happened earlier this season at Winchester. Fast forward here to Lucas Oil Raceway. Brandon Jones is confident and prepared for this race. In fact, he just watched the CRA race where Kyle Busch held off John Hunter Nemechek for a last lap pass and was able to get him by just a hair. Brandon Jones said he learned from that pass just a few moments ago that he could apply to tonight's race. Rick Allen.
And so Brandon Jones is going to have his hands full, obviously, out in front. He's got some hungry drivers that will be just behind him. Mason Mitchell, who comes off of a win. Ken Schrader. Very impressive. That man has been not only in the ARCA Racing Series, but across the country, racing in so many different types of races at different types of race tracks. And we take a look at the number or the numbers for the Lucas Oil Raceway.
Yeah, this racetrack is just under 0.7 miles. And this is the first racetrack that I ever came to that had progressive banking. You saw 7.5 degrees. That's at the very top, a lot flatter down at the bottom. You see our race length, 200 laps, our pit window, somewhere around 160 to 170 laps, but they'll be in there sooner than that.
So at least one stop from here at Lucas Oil Raceway. Let's get the engines fired. We go trackside for the command.
Scott Get Geared Up 200 presented by Federated Car Care on behalf of Scott Brand and Kimberly Clark, 200 Menards contractors, to give the command.
Two cars come to life as they're getting ready for 200 laps of white-knuckle short track racing from Lucas Oil Raceway. This is a racetrack that we have seen so many incredible finishes, great races. As you mentioned, there's going to be beating and banging. It is a short track, so you may use up the guy on the outside if you're trying to get by him.
They played nice last week in Chicago. It's not going to be quite as nice here. This is going to be some great short track action.
And we want to take a look at our Scott rookie spotlight. That would be Shannon McIntosh. She just turned 25 yesterday. That was her birthday. She's out of Middletown, Ohio. She will start in the 29th position, and this will be her very first ARCA Racing Series start tonight. So making her debut in the 72 this evening. We're going to ride along with a few different drivers. Phil, let's walk through them.
Yeah, let's ride along with Cody Coughlin. He's had 5 top 10 finishes in his 7 starts in his first season, and he will start the Jegs Toyota in the 16th spot.
We're also going to ride along with Grant Enfinger in the number 90. That Motor Honey Chevrolet is going to start 15th tonight. He's currently second in the point standings with 4 wins already this year.
We're going to ride along with our rookie point leader, Austin Wayne Self. He will drive the AM Technical Solutions Dodge, and he will start from the 8th spot.
We're also on board with Justin Boston. He's currently 6th in the point standings and will start 6th tonight in the Zloop Toyota. He got his first win earlier this year at Toledo.
Why don't we ride along with last week's winner and our point leader, Mason Mitchell. He had a brief victory celebration in his hometown in Iowa and then right back to work here to try to make it two in a row.
We'll see if that momentum pays off for Mason Mitchell as the cars are now rolling around this, would you call it just over a 5/8 mile racetrack?
Yeah.
Just under 7/10
yeah,
out there?
Over a big 5/8. Let's call it a big 5/8.
So this racetrack, as you mentioned, progressive banking. We've seen racing about 2 to 3 grooves up. I would expect that as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Right against the wall will probably be the majority of the places people run.
When we come back, it's Green Flag Racing. Currently making their way around Lucas Oil Raceway as we get ready for the green flag. Is there a favorite out there, Phil? Is there somebody that you look at and say Mason Mitchell with his, obviously, momentum coming off the big win at Chicagoland, or potentially Brandon Jones gets back to victory lane and stays perfect?
How about the experience with Kenny Schrader back in row number two? 59 years old, Kenny Schrader's been racing all over the country. He goes to Edmonton, Alberta, next week to race. Probably race more times than anybody in this field this year.
You mentioned the word veteran and experience, and you have to go with 10-time ARCA champion Frank Kimmel. Jim Tradel.
And he said this is a pivotal racetrack for him. 2 years ago, he won his 75th race and put him back on the map and towards his 10th championship. Tonight, he starts 10th with a brand new crew chief, Mark Rett, who's in the Wintron Stables, who also worked with Mason Mingus last year in a championship hunt here in ARCA. The team thought they'd pair Frank with Mark Rett. It starts tonight, but Frank from 10th said, I didn't know what I had for a race car until the final moments of practice. So look for Kimmel, really defending race winner here from 2 years ago, to move forward, but it may be an uncertain category here for Kimmel because that car had so many changes in practice, they finally hit on something right at the end of the second practice session.
Bobby Gerhart was stopped on pit road, and Phil, I believe they were changing a shock.
Yeah, they definitely had a shock off that 5 car and put one back on it. So he will have to go back to the back of the pack for the start, Wendy.
Yeah, I'm just listening to more radio communication from his crew chief, and it sounds like that they worked fixing the shock, and then he just complained something about it overheating as well. So we're going to continue to follow Bobby Gerhart's beginning of the race before the green flag even falls here. Now, this is a short track car that Bob Schack put together for Bobby Gerhart. Now, Bobby Gerhart hasn't raced with us in quite some time, but no doubt is prepared here coming into this event, but unfortunately has some mechanical issues before the green flag even drops.
Pretty aggressive maneuver.
Yeah, let's do it now, though. Do it while we're on their pace laps. All we're going to have to do is give up our starting position, have to start from the back, but that's a whole lot better than something happening on the green.
You think it's possible to go back to back with wins in your first two starts?
Yeah, absolutely.
What Brandon Jones is trying to do.
Yeah, we've seen that happen before. Alex Bowman, I believe, did that here in the ARCA Racing Series, if I'm not mistaken, 2-3 years ago.
That's the back gate that they're opening up, and the reason for that is we need to get an ambulance into the infield before the start of this one.
That's why they delayed the start a lap.
So that is now taken care of. And they have told the field that they will get the one to go sign next time by. How about already Grant Enfinger with 4 wins on the 2014 season, but not your points leader.
Now Mason Mitchell took over that point lead last week with that big win at Chicagoland. All top 10 finishes for Mason Mitchell. That's how you win a championship, is consistency. And that young man is extremely consistent. Again, that's 11 of 20 in a row top 10 finishes.
Wendy Venerini.
Just want to talk about Kenny Schrader before we get this race started. Kenny is a racer's racer, and of course we know he's raced 7 times in the last 8 days. He's taken his camper along with his son Sheldon. I saw his wife Ann out here selling t-shirts this morning. Ken Schrader feels good about it. This is only his 5th ARCA start this season. He finished 4th at Winchester and 4th at Toledo. And guess what, folks? He's led 2,400 laps here in the ARCA Series, 2,490 to be precise. If he leads 10 more laps, that's a good record for Kenny Schrader. It'll be 2,500 laps in the ARCA Series. He's not giving up the steering wheel anytime soon. Kenny Schrader is awfully busy in his short track racing.
Kenny actually ran the Silver Crown race last night. He said the first time in over 20 years he's been in a Silver Crown car, had a top 10 finish.
I remember it was last year Ken Schrader said, you know what I think I'm going to do? I'm going to run the full ARCA Racing Series schedule just so I can
Terrorize.
Give Frank Kimmel a hard time.
Terrorize Frank Kimmel.
The field is in line, 2-by-2. It's Brandon Jones that won the poll earlier. He will pace that field with Mason Mitchell on his outside. Brandon Jones has chose the inside line as they come out of turn number 4. Green flag in the air from Lucas Oil Raceway.
You see the 88, Justin Allison, jump out of line there before the start. Not supposed to do that. He jumped by Kenny Schrader. Our officials will look at that.
Was that a mistake to choose the inside line for Brandon Jones?
Well, I think Mason Mitchell got such a good jump from the outside, he actually was the first car to go after dropping the green flag.
And out in front of this field, it's Mason Mitchell. We mentioned momentum. He's the last one to find victory lane in the ARCA Racing Series, and he's the first one to lead a lap here at Lucas Oil Raceway tonight.
The ARCA racing officials looked at that start. The 4 car spun his tires, and the accordioning effect is what had the 88 jump out of line. So no penalty for anybody.
Justin Allison will be able to hold on to his spot. Right now it's 5th. Mason Mitchell out in front of Brandon Jones. Tom Hessert up into the 3rd spot. Justin Boston is 4th. And again, Justin Allison in the 5th position.
That's Justin Allison, the 88 car on the outside, racing Austin Wayne Self, the 22. That is a battle for position. Right behind them, J.J. Haley and Kenny Schrader battling for position as well.
Top 4 have spread themselves out and separated themselves from the pack. Who's running just behind the 88. Justin Allison, but as you mentioned, that 22 working over the inside. Austin Wayne Self trying to take that spot away.
So difficult to make that pass on the inside. Again, a little bit flatter right now where Austin Wayne Self is running. It's a little flatter than it is right up against the wall where the 88 of Justin Allison's running.
You mentioned beating and banging short track racing. We see Austin Wayne Self now to the inside of the 52 of Kenny Schrader. Is there going to have to be a little contact to maybe get by someone? Or is that preferred line the outside line and you have to make the passes to the high side?
Well, we saw Kenny Schrader just now make that pass. Austin Wayne Self was trying to use the middle of the racetrack to get by the 80 to Justin Allison. Wasn't able to work. Kenny Schrader took advantage of that, jumped to the outside, and made the pass on Austin Wayne Self. Now J.J. Haley in the 66 is going to try to do the same thing.
Austin Wayne Self down in the 22. Is it going to be 3 wide? John West Townley on the inside in the 15. Right in the middle of that 3 wide was the 60 of Kyle Weatherman. We ride along with 55 of Cody Coughlin.
Cody actually had a power steering belt come off during practice and lost his primary car. This is a backup car. He was able to get out in the 2nd practice session and practice with this car, but that's not the car they intended on racing here.
Here we go, battle for 3rd.
Kenny Schrader going to try to make that middle work on Justin Allison. Justin Allison's been very impressive this year in the limited number of starts in that 88 car.
Justin Allison, just over a handful of starts already, has a career best finish of 3rd that came at Michigan, the 2-mile Michigan Speedway.
See Justin Boston, the 25 car, makes the pass on the 77 of Tom Hessert. Tom Hessert is very good at this racetrack. The last time we were here in 2012, he finished 2nd. The year before that, he finished 5th.
There was a hiatus in 2013. The ARCA Racing Series didn't come back here until this year. They got back on the schedule. Always put on a great show on the short tracks. Right now, they're doing just that. Mason Mitchell out in front has a 0.5-second lead over Brandon Jones, but there is 2-by-2 battles back in this field.
Yeah, Cody Coughlin, the 55, able to make that pass on Blake Hillert in the 10. Carl Weber, the 3 car, trying to pull up on the back bumper of that 10 of Blake Hillert.
Just behind them, Michael Lira in the 69. There's the gap between 1 and 2. Mason Mitchell able to grab the top spot away from Brandon Jones right at the green flag start of this race. Tomorrow it's a doubleheader here on Fox Sports 1 as Bryce Harper and the Nationals take on the Reds, followed by the Indians battling Salvador Perez and the Royals. Coverage begins tomorrow, 3:30 p.m. Eastern on Fox Sports 1 and streaming live on Fox Sports Go. Doubleheader Saturday.
Great view from our 3rd place driver right there, Justin Boston.
Here's the gap between 1 and 2. Mason Mitchell continues to have about a 5-car length lead over Brandon Jones. Brandon Jones broke the track record earlier today in qualifying. Here's a battle for the 6th position. Justin Allison has that spot. J.J. Haley trying to take it away using that inside line.
You see how hard it was to get the power down on exit of the corner there really has a tendency to spin the tires when you're down there on the flatter part of the racetrack. J.J. Haley had the pole at Elko, Minnesota, the youngest ever pole sitter in the history of ARCA, and finished third in that race. Great job by that young man.
Stay nose to tail. Now Haley looks to the inside once again, trying to find a way to gain a little ground on that 88 of Allison. Yes, that is the Allison of fame out of the Alabama game.
Donnie's grandson, Justin, doing a real nice job this year.
Really has, and it's been fun to see Donnie at so many tracks this year following his grandson.
So much so involved with Justin's career. It has been since the very start.
I believe Justin Allison has been impressing not only grandpa, but a lot of the fans and owners around the stock car world.
You know, Jim touched on it earlier. I was talking to the car owner for the 88, Howard Bixman, who also owned Grant Enfinger's car before the big switch this week. And I said, hey, how did that switch go? He said this was an unbelievable opportunity for Grant Enfinger. He said, I absolutely think the world of him. There's no way I was going to stand in his way and keep him from doing that opportunity. So he said that was with our total blessings.
Now working by the lap traffic, Bobby Gearhart on the lap down. As that battle for sixth continues. And coming into the picture, Justin Boston in the 25. So the top three have separated themselves. Randy Jones still holding on to second, but here comes that 25 of Justin Boston.
Remember, we saw Justin Boston win right here on Fox Sports at Toledo earlier this year for his first ever ARCA Series win. I believe he wants another one here. He's caught that four car.
Justin Boston, the short track, Toledo getting his first career win, getting comfortable. So many races, Justin Boston would tell me that, you know, things just wouldn't work out. We either had a heart failure or, you know, something went wrong on pit road. It just wouldn't work out for this young man, but he's finally been able to get back or get to victory lane.
Was a contender all year long last year. We knew he would be a contender for the championship and really had a tough time starting out. Had a lot of bad luck that you were talking about. But the last three events, fourth, third, and second. So he's on track now.
Grant Enfinger, this is what he has to look forward to. Just in front of him is Matt Tift in the 11. Enfinger goes down low. Grant Enfinger, four wins already in the 2014 season. When he started out at Daytona to kick off the 2014 season, didn't know if he would run the full season, but he started off pretty well.
And that's one of the reasons Howard Bixman said, hey, you have my blessings to go for this other team here, because they weren't sure that they were going to have the funding to run the entire season. So he's doing a nice job moving up here. Got by that 22 of Austin Wayne Self, moved up into the 10th, 9th spot now.
The Alabama native started off the season with three consecutive wins, and that made them decide to go for that championship. As we see Frank Kimmel right in the middle trying to get by Bobby Gearhart as well. Austin Wayne Self in the 22 just in front of Kimmel now. Kimmel with 80 wins, and a lot of those on short tracks.
He's our most recent winner here. Won here a couple years ago. Ty Dillon won here back in 2011. He'll be racing over the big track at the Brickyard tomorrow in the Nationwide Series race. We'll have qualifying right here tomorrow on Fox Sports.
Another driver that's going to race in that Nationwide race, we just saw a glimpse of him, the 15 of John West Townley.
He's had a busy several days here.
Yeah, definitely has.
He will run five major races over the course of 8 days. He ran two at Chicagoland, the ARCA Racing Series, as well as the Nationwide race. And then he ran the truck race Wednesday at Eldora, and tonight and tomorrow.
A lot of different disciplines, and things are heating up front now. You've got Mason Mitchell trying to get by some of this lap traffic, but that has enabled the four of Brandon Jones to close the gap. Just two car lengths separating the top two, as Mason Mitchell has to go all the way down to almost the apron to get by some of these lap cars.
Yeah, they were side by side, the lap cars, not wanting to go a lap down. Mason Mitchell, he's the very bottom of the racetrack. You see second, third right now, right on the bottom as well. Jones in Boston.
29 laps complete, now 30 complete for Mason Mitchell. And already 14 cars on the lead lap is all. That means 18 of them have been lapped.
Yeah, these guys have set a pretty torrid pace right now.
And how about the manufacturer parity we have? a Ford, a Chevrolet, a Toyota, and a Dodge up front.
Well, that's about all we have to in the four manufacturers.
Pretty impressive.
You see what a break Brandon Jones got that time. He was able to get by that lap car, get up to the outside of the third line. And as he drives away from Justin Boston in the 25, remember, Boston had chased him down here just a few laps ago.
Yeah, Boston had to go all the way to the bottom of the racetrack, lost a little momentum down there, and lost a little of the ground that he had made up on second place Brandon Jones. And now Mason Mitchell trying to check out once again on second place. The gap is back in the Scott Get Geared Up 200. Between one and two, they've separated themselves by six car lengths again. Mason Mitchell out in front of Brandon Jones. Justin Boston back there in the third spot.
Yeah, these guys are really running similar lap times. That last time, Justin Boston was a little bit quicker than both Mitchell and Jones. Cars pretty even right now, those top three cars.
Yeah, they've separated themselves from fourth place. Tommy Hessert, Ken Schrader back there in the fifth position. J.J. Haley in sixth. Justin Allison seventh. Matt Tift in eighth. Grant Infinger ninth. Michael Self rounds out our top ten. And once again, it looks as though Brandon Jones has found a little bit of speed. He's able to close the gap down to about a half a second or three car lengths.
This is a great race right here. You see John West Towner, the 15, right behind the 22 of Austin Wayne. So Frank Kimmel all the way down at the bottom of the racetrack. Here comes the 60 of Kyle Weatherman to join that battle.
Most of the time we mentioned they're trying to find grip, trying to find a way to have an advantage over the guy they're racing against. At this racetrack, it seems like you can go about anywhere. The preferred line looks to be a little bit higher, but we're seeing guys making some moves on the bottom of the racetrack.
Yeah, we saw John West Townley take advantage of Austin Wayne Self trying to go to the bottom of the racetrack. He was able to get, now he may get blocked in by the 29 of Wayne Edwards.
Wayne Edwards run that higher line, saw a little bit of smoke come out from behind one of those two cars.
I think maybe John West Townley locked the brakes up a little bit as he followed the 29 in the corner. Now they continue side by side.
Wayne Edwards almost into the wall as he came out of turn number two. These three cars all fighting for position. West Townley in the 10th spot.
Austin Wayne Self's car was really good through the center of the corner. We saw Frank Kimmel, that 44 car, move to the outside. It looks like he was going to be able to get up beside the 22, but Austin Wayne Self was able to jump on that throttle and center of the corner and squeeze out in front of him. This is what the smoke we saw here. You see him, how quickly he approached John West Townley, the 15, approached Wayne Edwards, and I think he locked the brakes up.
And had Austin Wayne Self in the 22 on his inside, so nowhere to go. Have to check up. Brandon Jones continues to try to reel in that 98, but doesn't seem to be making much progress, Wendy.
Well, Brandon Jones' biggest concern is his windshield. He actually called into the team and asked if it was raining out on the racetrack because his windshield is covered in fluid. He reported that there was also a car smoking. They do not know if it's the 98 of Mitchell in front of them, but they do know that a car has laid down a lot of fluid. Jim Trado.
Wendy, no discussion on the radio from the driver or their team or the car. Just ahead of Brandon, our race leader, the number 98 of Mason Mitchell. Mitchell's lead has shrunk a bit here because he said his car is becoming loose off. The car is sliding up the racetrack. He's had to make one more tug on the wheel to keep control of that number 98 Ford. One thing Mason did say a few laps ago was, I'm trying to save my stuff. I learned something at Chicagoland, and what a confidence builder that win was. I learned something there that's helping me through the corners to not burn my stuff up. But at this point, I think he's got his hands full here with Brandon Jones closing.
Such an incredible strategy taking place. And you look at this and it does look like it's raining, or at least somebody is leaking fluid. Sometimes that's overflow.
Yeah, it certainly does. Now that's Justin Boston. They've been complaining a little bit about maybe Mason Mitchell possibly leaking something. That's what Brandon Jones, the four car, was complaining about, but there's certainly something on the windshield of that 25 of Justin Boston. And you really typically don't get that much oil or debris on a windshield on a short track. You don't get sandblasted like you do
right
at a lot of the mile naps and the bigger racetracks.
So that might be something we've got to keep our eye on as far as Mason Mitchell potentially having some fluid coming out of the overflow. Might be getting a little bit warmer.
Was crew chief Shane Huffman complaining from one of the ARCA officials that there's something getting on their windshield?
We haven't seen anyone slipping and sliding, so it doesn't look like the fluid's getting down on the track. It looks like it's airborne.
Exactly right, but that is certainly disconcerting. Hard enough to see out of these cars, but without something on the windshield like that.
Fourth of the race, almost in the books already, as we're about to complete lap number 50. And it has been all Mason Mitchell since the drop of the green flag. Brandon Jones started on the inside line. Mason Mitchell on the outside of the initial start of this race. You look on board with Mason Mitchell. A pretty clean windshield, but at the same time, when you see the light reflect there, we're seeing some of the same streaking.
It is, yeah, but it's not as bad as I don't believe Justin Boston's windshield. So obviously there's a car. Actually, that shot right there with that one light coming off turn four looks a lot like the windshield on the 25 of Justin Boston.
Could have been someone that they were following behind as they put a lap down. But right now it's Mason Mitchell setting the pace here at Lucas Oil Raceway. And we are getting under our first caution, the 66 of J.J. Haley. Haley was running in the seventh spot. He gets turned around and has some damage to the rear of that car.
Yeah, JJ was doing a great job. He spends his weeks at Charlotte running a legend car at the summer shootout, but he's made some pretty significant contact. Let's see what happens. It looks like he's by himself here as he goes down in turn number three.
Oh, and wheel hop too.
Looks like he got on the brakes, maybe wheel hop just a little bit, and around come the back end into the outside wall.
Look forward. From Austin Wayne Self's vantage point.
Fortunately, just a single car incident, but a tough break for J.J. Haley, doing such a great job.
All right, Phil, we're in our pit window. We come to pit road, and we don't have to go back, right?
Absolutely. I think we do that, too. I think we want to come in now, go ahead and at least put our first set of tires on. Then we have the option of coming in later if we want, or we know that we have enough fuel now to get to the end of the race.
So strategy could come into play later. You don't need to top off, but if you want to come in for maybe a two-tire stop late.
Or maybe even put another set of tires. These teams will have two sets of tires in the pits, eight tires that they can put on whenever they want. They have to stop. The rule is they have to stop before lap 190, but I don't think anybody can go that far anyway. I think we're going to see almost everybody, if not everybody, come down pit road this time.
Seeing the crews make their way up on the wall. They will get ready to service these cars. And pit road is open. The inner pit road from the back stretch going into turn number three. So they will make that commitment as they get ready to dive down onto that access road. And
Mason Mitchell comes to pit road.
Our race leader is going to make his way onto pit road, but Brandon Jones and Justin Boston stay out. So differing strategies here in our top three.
I think just about every other lead lap car is coming on pit road, Jim.
And Mason Mitchell calling for just a minor change. This team worked 2 weeks ago into the nighttime to get this car right. Minor changes all day long. 1 pound out of the left rear tire is what they're going to do with four Hoosier tires and the Sunoco fuel. Small changes here for his crew chief now, talking about turning the fans on and off. Earlier they were talking about turning the front fans on to get that car to turn better. But nonetheless, they're going to go to a four-tire change. A bit of a slow stop here with the right rear hung up now on the 98 machine. Wendy?
Ken Schrader was in for four tires and an air pressure adjustment. He was a little bit tight, but he did have trouble on pit road as his jackman did go down for a fall as he came around to the left side of the race car. Guys,
how about the three-wide battle coming off of pit road?
Fight to come off of pit road. Grant Enfinger in the 90 on the inside of that three-wide battle. John Westtown in the 15 was on the far outside. Matt Tift also involved in that in the 11. So Mason Mitchell decides to come onto pit road, and the other two in the top three don't. It's a news break with Jenny Tapp coming up next. Scott, get geared up 200. 58 laps already in the books. It was all Mason Mitchell from the start of this race, and he decided that with this first caution coming out that he would take the opportunity to make his way to pit road. And while doing that, The guys running second and third stayed out. So now we have a new leader. Brandon Jones will be out front. Justin Boston will be in the second spot.
Trouble on pit road for Mason Mitchell. He saw them leave a lug nut off the right rear. They had to come back around, jack it back up to put the lug nut back on. Saw the little bit of water coming out of the overflow. That's just because they're running slow right. Under caution speed. That should clear out as we go back up to speed here in just a couple more laps.
Get some air back in to the radiator. So Brandon Jones, after winning the pole earlier today in a track record pace, chose the inside line for the initial start of this race. Do you think he's going to choose the inside again?
I would choose the outside. Now, yeah. But that's not how he lost the lead. He actually spun the tires on the initial start. That's what the ARCA racing officials saw, and that's why they didn't penalize Justin Allison for jumping down out of line on the inside.
And the four is going to choose the outside line as they give him one to go, Wendy.
Well, as you mentioned, only one car chose not to come down pit road. That's Brandon Jones that you're looking at right now, our leader. The crew chief, Shane Huffman, said they wanted to get to around lap 75, which isn't that far away. But Brandon Jones told me before the race the biggest concern was saving his tires. And he also told me that the best groove for him was that top groove. So no surprise, he's choosing the top line. Jim?
Well, the drivers second and third of the championship point standings came down pit road. The number 90 of Grant Enfinger came in, gave up 10 spots, but he had to get the car to help drive off better. So as crew chief Pickle Lennon said, 1 pound out of the left rear to help the car drive off. Also one round in the right rear on the adjustment wrench. Also Frank Kimmel in. Four tires. The car, he said, was so tight he couldn't turn the thing. So good opportunities for the drivers battling for the points championship with Mason Mitchell here tonight.
Field 2x2. Brandon Jones on the outside, Justin Boston on the inside, green flag back in the air.
A lot better start that time for Brandon Jones. Justin Boston's gonna try to keep pace on the inside. A lot of fresh tires behind him though, three wide.
Here comes Matt Tift on the high line. He's gonna try to get on the outside of that 25 of Justin Boston. And here comes Grant Enfinger, throwing it in hard on the low end of this racetrack.
Look how flat it is down there. But remember, he has new tires. A couple of those guys have older tires.
Three wide as they came out of turn number four. Grant Enfinger all the way down to the bottom of the racetrack. There's still three wide for second place.
That's how to do it. Use those new tires when you can. That's when you have the most grip. You have to go down to the bottom of the racetrack.
Three wide again as they go through three and four. Here comes Matt Tift challenging for the lead as they come out of four. Tift is going to be your race leader.
What a great move by Matt Tift. Another one of the cars with fresh tires to take over the lead.
Brandon Enfinger trying to make that low line work, and he is going to take second away now. Brandon Jones and Justin Boston on older tires, not able to hang on to those top two spots. They drop back to third and fourth.
See, Mason Mitchell, our early leader, now jumps down to the inside, trying to get underneath that 88 of Justin Allison.
And here comes Grant Enfinger once again. He'll look to the inside. The battle for the lead continues. Enfinger trying the lower line. Matt Tift a little bit higher up the racetrack.
But look at the racing behind him. You see the four car right now. Brandon Jones holding up the rest of those cars. He's on old tires. Mason Mitchell dives in the inside, but Justin Boston cuts him off.
Here comes Mason Mitchell looking to the inside in that 98. How about John West Townley? All over the back bumper. The four of Brandon Jones. Three wide now for position once again.
We know how good that 98 car Mason Mitchell has been this entire race. He has fresher tires in that 25, and he's able to make the pass.
Kenny Schrader working that high line, trying to get by Justin Boston. He'll set his sights on Mason Mitchell next. He has the preferred line here at Lucas Oil Raceway.
Tom Hester trying to get down underneath Justin Boston in the 25. That's Tom Hester in the 77. And here comes Frank Kimmel to the outside of Hester.
Fresh tires certainly giving a lot of these guys confidence. They're trying to get everything they can after this most recent restart. Right along with Austin Wayne Self as he looks forward at 10-time champion Frank Kimmel looking to the inside of that 44.
See Brandon Jones right there, the four car. He's right now in the third spot, really holding this field up. See John West Townley, the 15, trying to get underneath him. There's Mason Mitchell side by side. He's the 98, the 88 of Justin Allison. Right now, I think those guys may be rethinking that decision to stay out and not come to pit road to get tires.
We'll see how long they have to stay out. Maybe it will work out for them because we've seen how much better fresher tires are as the battle for that lead continues up in front. Matt Tift trying to hold off Grant Enfinger. Once again, Enfinger all the way to the bottom of the racetrack. Tip that time went down a little bit lower to try to pinch the 90 down. They are side by side once again as they come out of turn four.
Great short track racing here. Matt Tip doing a nice job keeping Grant Enfinger behind him, but Grant is using that bottom of the racetrack. He's getting pretty good grip down there.
This could play into the four of Brandon Jones as well as the 25 of Justin Boston. Those two cars stayed out on the older tires. If these guys continue to fight for the lead like Grant Enfinger just taking it away from Matt Tip, that's side-by-side racing wearing away those fresh tires very quickly.
Yeah, but you see Brandon Jones, now he's lost the third and the fourth position in the danger of losing fifth to the 88 of Justin Allison.
On the lead lap, 13 cars. A lot of drivers that would have liked to have taken the wave around couldn't do it because of all of the cars that stayed out, or the two that stayed out, obviously with Brandon Jones.
And if we get a caution time, a caution flag any time in the next probably 10 to 20 laps, we know the four and the 25 are going to come to pit road, and more than likely our leader, Grant Enfinger, and the rest of these guys in the top 10 that stopped last time will stay out, so no more wave arounds either.
Justin Allison trying to get by on the inside. Brandon Jones in the four. Let's make that 88 stick to the bottom of the racetrack. Brandon Jones continuing to try to keep the momentum up high. Very close there.
Yeah, tough situation to be in for the four, Brandon Jones. He knows he doesn't have as good of tires as these other guys, but he's got to be careful and not get that car tore up while he's trying to keep these guys behind him.
Trying to hang on to as many positions as he can with the fresher tires. So trying to take advantage early. Justin Allison has to run that inside line because he's got the four of Brandon Jones on his outside. Wendy.
Justin Allison has run six races this season in the ARCA series and has done a very fine job finishing third at Michigan. Justin told me before this race his biggest struggle was the car was super tight throughout the whole entire day, and his goal was to keep the fenders on it. On lap 54, he came in for four tires, fuel, and an air pressure adjustment because he has been tight from the center out. Now also up front on the 11 with Matt Tift. You know, it's good when you race for Kenny Schrader because Matt Tift had never seen this racetrack before. So Matt has the same setup to start the day here at Lucas Oil Raceway that Kenny Schrader has in his machine. And Matt Tift also has been doing a fabulous job for Kenny Schrader. He has five starts here in the ARCA series. Finished third last week at Chicagoland on his first mile and a half and has three top threes finishes this season. Matt Tift doing a lap 54. He also came in, and had four tires and fuel for the 11 team. He's been strong so far at Lucas Oil.
Well, Matt Tift holding on to that second spot. Grant Enfinger able to get by him. But it is Mason Mitchell who led the most laps at 53. Grant Enfinger back out in front again in the ARCA Racing Series. Lucas Oil Raceway and the Scott DeGeared Up 200 for the ARCA Racing Series here in Claremont, Indiana, about 7 miles from the big track. Grant Enfinger out in front of this field. Matt Tift running in the second spot, but he's 1.3 seconds back. So Enfinger, after battling for quite a few laps side by side with Tift, has been able to make the pass and now pull away from second place Matt Tift.
Yeah, doing an amazing job here. First start for Gallagher Motorsports, GMS. Great opportunity for Grant Enfinger. We'll finish out the year with GMS, and what a way to start this thing off, leading this race here before halfway.
Yeah, if he could get back to victory lane, it would be five wins in the 2014 campaign in just this, the 12th race of the 20. And this is the 10th ARCA race here at Lucas Oil Raceway.
What a great facility, such a long history here. I ran the very first Busch Series race back in 1982 at this racetrack. And have loved coming here ever since.
Where'd you finish?
I didn't finish. I had trouble.
I think you told me that, so I probably shouldn't have brought it up.
Yeah,
thanks a lot.
Was
that a bad thing?
Yeah, thanks a lot.
Okay, I apologize.
I sat on the pole and finished fourth the next year.
Which is so much better of a story.
So much better, yeah, 1983. So.
How about Grant Enfinger? Look at his hands working inside that car.
Yeah, Matt Tift has closed right on the rear bumper. The heavy traffic that Grant Enfinger's been in. How about John West Townley? He was able to get by a lot of those cars, and that was close right up on the 11 of Matt Tift, and he's in a battle for second.
I'm trying to put Bobby Gerhardt, another lap down. Grant Infinger will work that inside line as he's caught up to some of these slower lap cars.
It's Thomas Prater, that two-car DK Lock. A lot of hospitality, entertaining a lot of people here, that sponsor. So great to have them aboard here in the ARCA Racing Series. Heavy traffic.
And now trying to work their way through. Could this be a lead change? Matt Tift gets stuck in behind the five of Bobby Gerhardt. Grant Infinger not able to clear that five. And now Matt Tift trying to help the five. He wants to get by so he can get this lead.
Our top four cars right there. John West Townley, the 15th, running third. There's Mason Mitchell, our early leader, right now running in the fourth spot, trying to get underneath the 15.
Back in the picture, Mason Mitchell trying to take third away from John West Townley. Down to the bottom of the racetrack. Townley tucks in behind Matt Tift in the 11.
Mason Mitchell's really worked the bottom of the racetrack. Hasn't really been able to make it work on John West Townley. He was able to get up to the fourth spot. He restarted eighth after that lap 62 caution flag.
As we reach the top of the hour, some great short track racing here for the ARCA Racing Series alongside Phil Parsons. I'm Rick Allen. By the way, I believe this is over 400 races that you and I have called together.
Yeah, it's been a great ride, buddy.
It's been an amazing ride. I'm very appreciative of everything you've been able to do to help my career, which I think you made it. You made my career.
Oh, yeah, sure. I'm sure I did. It's been a lot of fun. You've done an amazing job.
Yeah. Matt Tift trying to hold off John West Townley as, once again, Grant Infinger. It seems as though once they get away from the lap traffic, Grant Infinger is able to put some distance between himself. Has a little bit better car, but not in traffic.
Yeah, clear racetrack. He's definitely better right now. Matt Tift was able to gain on him in traffic, and here comes John West Townley. John West Townley has a great race car right now. He's going to grab that second spot.
Can he clear him? He does. So John West Townley moves up into the second position. Here comes Mason Mitchell. He's going to look to the outside of Matt Tift. Maybe Matt Tift used up his equipment a little bit earlier, fighting for that lead with Grant Infinger.
Yeah, he opened the door. They let Mason Mitchell get to his outside, and that's going to result in a pass for the third spot. Mason Mitchell wanted to be up there. He was trying to make the bottom work. Couldn't get by John West Townley, but he's got the third spot now.
Out in front, Grant Infinger continuing to pace the field. John West Townley running second. Matt Tift is third. Mason Mitchell fourth, and Ken Schrader in your top five. A little different view for John West Townley now, as he has been able to take over the lead in the Scott Get Geared Up 200 from Lucas Oil Raceway. Here's how it happened.
Grant Infinger gave John West Townley the outside, and he took advantage of it. He was able to chase down Grant Infinger, and he got there. Grant gave him the outside of the racetrack, and around he went.
And Mason Mitchell also was able to get by Grant Infinger, and so now it's John West Townley and Mason Mitchell up front. And the guys who were battling for the lead at the very beginning of this green flag run, Grant Infinger and Matt Tift, have dropped back to third and fourth. Maybe used up those tires a little bit early.
Could have, especially trying to run the bottom of the racetrack. There's another view of that pass for the lead by John West Townley. Riding along with Mason Mitchell right now. We're going to see Mason Mitchell go by as well.
So John West Townley pacing the field here at Lucas Oil Raceway, Jim.
Well, guys, he qualified an uncharacteristic 13th. I just checked with his crew chief, Jamie Jones, who's new this week to this team. Brad Parrott had been the crew chief of late. Now it's the turn for Jamie Jones. He said the car was tight all through practice. It was tight before we made that pit stop on the lap 55. They got the car turning better in the center. It was tight before. We're under yellow, guys.
Yeah, Bobby Gerhardt gets turned around, and it couldn't have come at a better time for guys like Brandon Jones and Justin Boston. Guys that didn't come to pit road earlier now can come to pit road. They're still on the lead lap and get fresh tires.
Yeah, they had fallen back to the 10th and the 11th spot now. Now they will have about 40 laps fresher tires than the rest of these guys up in the top 10, unless they decide to come in as well.
Yeah, that's the big question now. Strategy-wise, would a John West Townley or a Mason Mitchell make the hard left turn and come onto pit road for that last set of tires?
I don't think I would. Let's see if we can take a view here at what happened. That's Bobby Gerhardt right there in front of Justin Boston. Bobby does a nice job here keeping that car out of the outside wall.
Take a look at the right-hand side of your screen here. That is Bobby Gerhardt going around. And it looked like no contact. It was just got away, got loose from it.
8 wins at Daytona for Bobby Gerhart. Anytime you tee it up down there at Daytona or Talladega, you know you're going to have to beat Bobby Gerhart to win that race.
One of the favorites always when we go to Daytona and Talladega.
Really curious to see what the rest of these lead lap cars are going to do. We know that the 4 of Jones and the 25 of Boston are coming to pit road, but we don't know about these other guys. They may want to stay in sync, but that gives these other guys, Jones and Boston, with an extra set of tires on them if they come down here right now. I think they're all staying out, looks like, except Tom Hesett's going to make the hard left turn to come to pit road.
Here comes Brandon Jones as well as the 25. Justin Boston.
Kyle Weatherman's coming down pit road. Cody Coughlin coming down pit road. So almost all the top 10 cars stayed on the racetrack with the exception of Tom Hesert.
And let's go to Wendy Venerini.
Brandon Jones comes to a stop. This is the first time this car has hit pit road here in the race because they opted to stay out the last time around. He is a little bit tight on the left side of the wall, but it is going to be pretty solid stop, and they did make some air pressure adjustment and pulled that tear up off for Brandon Jones. Jim Prado.
Justin Boston's had a really strong car, top three all day long, top three in the race here. What they're going to do is they're going to change the tires, all four tires, and a tear-off. He desperately wanted the tear-off the first time they had a caution. They didn't come down pit road. This time, to get that car to rotate through the center, it was a bit tight in the center for Justin Boston. That's Luke car coming out second here. But they got what they needed. They got the caution. They got the tear-off off the four tires and a small adjustment by crew chief Billy Venturini on the box for Justin Boston in search of his second victory here this season.
And new to 2014, double file restart. So that will allow these two cars to make their way up to pretty much the back of the field, at least the lead lap cars that will help them out. Coverage from here in Indianapolis returns with nationwide qualifying beginning at noon from Indianapolis Motor Speedway. That'll be on Fox Sports 1 and streaming live on Fox Sports Go. Fox Sports, your home for complete NASCAR all season long.
That'll be the first time we've had knockout qualifying at the Brickyard.
So, Scott, get geared up 200 from Lucas Oil Raceway here in Claremont, Indiana. Short track racing on a Friday night for the ARCA Racing Series. John West Townley is your race leader. And the 98 of Mason Mitchell will start on the inside of row number one. Back there in row two, Grant Enfinger. Jim?
Well, we saw him take the lead and check out on these guys. Well, he and his crew chief, Pekka Lundin, were talking under this caution after staying out. What should we do if the car has certain tendencies? He said, I may have to drive the brake. The car is not exactly what I want in the center of the corner. They talked about turning the front fans on and off and leaving the rear fans on because they're worried about the heat buildup in these cars. Now, Phil, when it comes to the fans, how important are they on a short track like this when they get the rear tires heated up or even the brakes heated up under long green conditions?
Yeah, they're very important here because you can adjust the balance in that car just by turning a fan on or off one of your tires.
We'll see how the balance is for the 15 of John West Townley as he paces the field out of turn four. Green flag back in the air.
A great restart by Mason Mitchell. He drives it hard down to the corner. He may come off for two with a lead.
He's got the advantage as they go through two, but as you mentioned, he doesn't quite capture that top spot. It's John West Townley goes into turn number three and gets the front of that car just on the outside of the 98. Now it's Mason Mitchell who takes that top spot away, and Grant Enfinger is going to look to the inside of John West Townley for second.
Mason Mitchell used the bottom of the racetrack. That's the best time to do it, right after a restart when those tires are cold, and did the job.
Time to cycle through once again, and Mason Mitchell takes advantage of it. He had led 53 laps before now taking the lead back here at Lucas Oil Raceway as we have under 90 laps to go. 89 remain. Battle for second continuing. Enfinger on the inside. John West Townley on the outside.
Remember, we saw John West Townley take the lead from Grant Enfinger before that caution flag came out. Now it looks like Grant Enfinger wants that second spot back.
Side by side, Justin Boston in the 25. Frank Kimmel, the 44 on the outside.
Remember that 25, Justin Boston, fresh tires.
Fighting for the fifth spot. Here comes Matt Tift falling back as Justin Boston looks to the inside.
Justin Boston, that 25 car, restarted in the 10th position, already up to the fourth spot.
We'll see how well the tires work for Justin Boston. Here comes the four. Also, Brandon Jones trying to take advantage of those fresher tires early in this run.
Well, it looks like the combination of those four tires and that slight chassis adjustment that Billy Venturini made on that car has it working.
The third Grant Infinger, he does. So he takes the third spot away. Now we'll set his sights on second. John West Townley has it. And he's a teammate to this 25 of Justin Boston. Justin Boston about to take away second now for Townley.
Yeah, nothing John West can do here. Those fresh tires are working on that Saluk Toyota.
So Boston up to the second spot. These fresher tires, could it pay off and be the strategy that gets him to victory lane, as we see Tom Hesser also getting by the 44 of Frank Kimmel.
Tom Hesser was another one of those cars that came down pit road. It doesn't look like Brandon Jones in the four car is as strong as those other two cars that put fresh tires on, the 77 of Hesser, the 25 of Boston.
Yeah, Justin Boston went from 10th to 2nd in 5 laps, so really took advantage of those fresh tires. Whitney.
And talking about Tom Hesser, you know, he came down pit road at lap 54, got four tires, made an air pressure adjustment, decided to come back down pit road at lap 104 for a second time to take four tires because he needed help in the center of his race car. And that's exactly those adjustments that Kevin Caldwell, his crew chief, has made.
So Mason Mitchell has the lead, but the gap is starting to diminish between he and Justin Boston. Will the fresh tires grab the lead away from Mason Mitchell? Stay with us. Sunday live coverage from here in Indianapolis returns with NASCAR Race Day, with up-to-the-minute updates on the Sprint Cup race directly from the pits, and then later it's NASCAR Victory Lane. Coverage begins at 10 a.m. Eastern on Fox Sports 1 and streaming live on Fox Sports Go.
We've only got 7 races left to get in that chase, Rick.
Yeah, things are heating up. Is there a favorite you think that maybe Tony Stewart gets back to victory lane and gets into that chase mix?
Yeah, Tony Stewart was awfully good at Pocono. Speeding penalty took him out of contention for the win. This racetrack more similar to Pocono than any other.
Speaking of speeding, Justin Boston taking advantage of those four tires, sped right by the 98 of Mason Mitchell, took the lead away, and it took the inside line. So the fresher tires worked for the 25 of Boston. We ride along with him as he makes the pass.
Yeah, he's really made those four tires work here. A little bit bigger disparity than they thought there was going to be. We saw those guys lose about 10 seconds to the leader after they stayed on the racetrack. The leaders came down pit road and got tires. Now they're doing the same thing. He's opened up over a 2.5-second lead in just the last 4 or 5 laps.
Only one win for Justin Boston in his career, and it came earlier at Toledo, a short track win. It seems as though they have shaken the bad luck. A fourth, a third, and a second, the last 3 races for that team and Justin Boston. So things turning around for the 25 team as he looks very strong. Maybe gets his second career win here tonight.
He's looking awfully good. If we go green the rest of the way, then he's certainly going to be in the driver's seat. I think if we get another caution flag as we watch Austin Wayne Self in the 22 car right now running back in the 10th spot, then I think everyone's going to come back to pit road and everyone will have equal tires then.
13 are on the lead lap, and that's going to change soon because Michael Lira is about 21 seconds behind race leader Boston, and they're turning laps right around 23 seconds, 24 seconds a lap.
Kenny Schrader has really dropped back to the 12th spot. Kenny was racing up in the top 5 through most of this race. He's one of those cars, obviously, that stayed out on the racetrack. This most recent caution when the 25 of Boston came down pit road, got tires, as well as the 4 of Jones. And Kenny's falling back a little bit right now.
Boston Wayne Self in the 22, looking at the inside of Cody Coughlin in the 55. There's Justin Allison in the 88, also in this group.
Yeah, this battle's going on right in front of Ken Schrader. This is a battle. Cody Coughlin right now in the 9th spot. Matt Tipp right in front of him in the 11th car is an 8.
Those 4 continue to fight it out. And Matt Tipp in the 11th holding on to the 8th position.
Cody Coughlin's doing a nice job right now racing. A little bit of contact from Austin Wayne Self, trying to move him out of the way a little bit.
And we're starting to see a little bit more of that short track mentality where you do put a fender to a guy to try to move him out of the way. Austin Wayne Self trying to take advantage of that, but it looks as though that might almost be helping Justin Allison as he gets to the outside of the 22, and a little contact made there too.
A little bit of contact. Justin Allison's going to take advantage of that 22 car DM being down on the bottom, and he may make it three wide. He's got a good run off of two.
Three wide, fourth position. Justin Allison on the inside. And how about the rotors starting to heat up a little bit? You see the left front of the 88 of Justin Allison. Hard on the brakes at this racetrack.
Absolutely here. Long, just really short straightaways and long corners here. But you want to drive these cars hard down to the corner and then get on those brakes.
Battle for the third spot. Hesser in the 77 on the right side of your screen. Brandon Jones in the four has been able to get up to that third position. Hasn't worn the good off the tires completely yet. Brandon Jones still trying to take advantage of a little bit fresher tires for that four car.
Those three young drivers right there battling in front of Ken Schrader. Brandon Jones tries to get to the inside of Tom Hesert. Once again, remember, Tom Hesert also came down pit road with the four of Brandon Jones and the 25 of Boston and put fresh tires on.
Brandon Jones to the inside. Tommy Hesert on the outside in the 77. Just come up on one of the lapped cars. Brandon Jones using up those four tires.
And these guys find themselves 6 seconds behind our leader right now, Justin Boston. We talked about him having a 2.5 second lead over Mason Mitchell a few laps ago. Paul, make that 5 second lead right now.
Yeah, 5 seconds separating one and two. Justin Boston has really checked out now on second place Mason Mitchell. There's Mason Mitchell just in front of that two car battle. There's your race leader, Justin Boston, in his loop. Toyota Camry. And the gap back 5 seconds to second place Mason Mitchell.
Justin did a really nice job of using those new tires, using them quickly, as we see John Westholly right now, who's falling back to the fifth spot.
Jim Tredo, why is he falling back?
One reason could be tire heat. The left front has been glowing behind the wheel inside the fender well. They believe it's a piece of rubber stuck in the spring inside the left front fender of the number 15 Saxman Toyota. Now keep in mind, the brakes have been glowing, but the fire is behind the tire. This could be huge for the left front wear on that machine. It's been on fire for the last 8, 9, 10 laps now in the car running fifth right now.
You know, it's not directly behind the tire. It's actually a little bit underneath the carriage there that we're seeing flames actually underneath the 15.
Yeah, I'm not sure if that may be some rubber that has come off these tires and actually collected. The headers are so hot that may have ignited that rubber, as we see a side-by-side battle right now between Austin Wayne Self, Matt Tift. Austin Wayne Self's going to get that spot. He moves him up to eight.
Didn't take long for Austin Wayne Self to get by Matt Tift. So the eighth position for Austin Wayne Self and the sparks. And flames still continue underneath the 15. John Westholly. Still see those sparks flying from underneath. Looks like maybe the fire out.
Yeah, I don't believe if it's there, I don't believe it's nearly as bad as it was.
So Justin Boston with almost a 7 second lead over Brandon Jones, who's jumped back up into the second spot. It's been a hot night already for John Westholly. Welcome back to Lucas Oil Raceway, your top three. The ARCA Racing Series, Scott Get Geared Up 200. All came onto pit road at lap 104. Apparently those fresher tires have worked out for Justin Boston, Brandon Jones, and Tom Hesser.
A lot of these guys right now trailing that top three are hoping for a caution flag. With just over 50 laps to go, would be just about the right time.
Justin Allison is the last car on the lead lap, and Allison currently running in the 10th position. With Brandon Jones running in the second spot. He's about 6 seconds back from Justin Boston.
It's a battle, side-by-side battle for position. Brandon thing with the 90 car along with Austin Wayne Self. Austin Wayne Self now has that seventh spot.
Initially, I think we were a little surprised that we didn't see Brandon Jones and Justin Boston come onto pit road earlier in this race, but now it looks as though that is potentially the winning strategy.
Yeah, without a doubt, the right call for those guys, the way cautions fell. Here's Mason Mitchell coming to pit road. This is an unscheduled pit stop for Mason Mitchell.
He was in the top six, running in the fourth spot, actually, when he came to pit road.
Remember, he's our point leader.
Jim Tredo, what's going on with the 98?
They're thinking their rear gears are starting to burn. He can smell it in the car. There's temperature there. He just made the quick call to his team. Crew chief Matt Weber said, bring it behind the wall. They're going to try to change the rear gear here, not lose too many laps. But Matt Weber now handling the jack and shouting instructions simultaneously. Rear gear on the 98, our point leader and early race leader here at Lucas Oil.
Doesn't have a DNF on the 2014 season, and that's why he is your race leader, but it doesn't look like he's going to go back to back as far as race wins.
No, and 20 top 10s in a row coming in here for Mason Mitchell. What a horrible break for this young man. Worked and worked and worked and worked with consistency. A bunch of second place finishes. Finally got the win last week at Chicagoland. Got the point lead, and now he's going to watch it slip away right here.
Ray Citarelli is currently in the 20th position, and he's 17 laps down. So I don't think you can change your rear gear in 17 laps here, can you? More
no.
Than 24 seconds a lap?
Absolutely not. Right now, Finney is in the 22nd spot. He's 63 laps down, and that would be a stretch.
So they're trying to potentially save a 22nd place finish for this team as they run for a championship. As we continue to see Justin Boston out in front of the field, he has a 5.2-second lead over Brandon Jones. Matt Tift just went a lap down, and Matt running in the eighth position.
But only 46 laps to go now, so he's going to finish at least in the 22nd position. Maybe could beat A.J. Fike right now, who's in the 21st spot.
So big changes for your points leader here at Lucas Oil Raceway. Unbelievable turn of events here in the Scott. Get geared up 200. Race leader Justin Boston wasn't involved in the reason for the caution. It was the 5 of Bobby Gerhardt who got turned around coming out of turn number 2. But Justin Boston, under caution, came up and hit the 5, and that's the damage to race leader Justin Boston. Now he's on pit road to try to fix this.
The car sat there for a long time. Bobby Gerhardt sat there for a long time, and we were just watching along, and Jim, he just ran into him.
This is maybe one of two changes. Billy Venturini, the crew chief, went into repair mode immediately, saying, this is what we need to do. Get the fenders away from the tires. Let's change the 4 tires, then worry about the body. The right front nose is getting yanked. You can see the damage on the left front. Very substantial here by the headlight area all the way up to the top center of the wheel. They're worried about the fender rub here just now. They may come back in again, Wendy.
Brandon Jones, who was our race leader at the time after Justin Boston's accident, came down pit road, took 4 tires. He was loose in his entry of his race car. They made an air pressure adjustment. Keep in mind, he had a set of stickers remaining here on pit road, and they did utilize those on this lap 159 pit stop.
Phil, I'm not sure I've ever seen something as crazy as what we just saw, and you're going to be able to see it now. Bobby Gerhardt in the 5 is going to spin. That's going to bring out the caution. But Bobby Gerhardt gets up against the wall. Wait for it.
And we skipped a little bit. There was a lot of time.
There was time.
In between those two pieces of video there. See, everybody's slowing down. He locks up the brakes. He sees him. He committed to the high side. Locks up the brakes. Actually runs into the outside wall first.
The field is frozen when the caution comes out, which means Justin Boston didn't need to stay at speed going through turns 1 and 2. You see the fender's been pulled away.
Obviously didn't realize that the caution flag was out.
So Justin Boston will make his way back to pit road.
Half a lap and going back to green. The race leader came down pit road, and he mentioned to his drivers, his team, once he left, the 25 driver said, that's on me. I could not hear the spotter. I'm sorry, guys. It was all on me. Brendan Poole, his spotter, said, can you hear me now? He said, yes, but it's been intermittent all race long.
And that could take a win away from Justin Boston. Now out front, Brandon Jones, Tom Hetson, green flag back in the air.
Poor Brandon Jones with those four new tires are going to make use of them right here.
And he checks out right now on Tom Hessert as they go down the backstretch. Frank Kimmel has made his way up into the third spot now. John West Townley and Matt Tift, your top five.
I'm not sure anybody else in the field had fresh tires left in the pits other than the 25 of Justin Boston.
And he did put those on because they came to pit road to fix the damage to the front end. But will the tires help him out enough to get him back up to the front?
Well, they're going to help him out now. If there's not any suspension damage and the toe end is not knocked out, then he should be able to maybe move by all these cars, but it's going to be awfully hard for him to race with that four car with fresh tires and no damage.
Austin Wayne Self in the 22. We're riding along with him as he was looking to the inside of the 15 of John West Townley. Here comes Grant Infinger as well.
Where did Frank Kimmel come from now, taking over the third spot?
Frank Kimmel up there in the third position. He's got Tom Hessert just behind him in the 77. Matt Tift as well back there. So Frank Kimmel has grabbed the second spot away from Hessert and Tift. And Kimmel will try to reel in that four of Brandon Jones. Still not moving forward is the 25 of Justin Boston as we ride along.
Ooh, close call right there with the 15 of John West Townley.
Pressure tires aren't helping Justin Boston as now the race for second builds. Matt Tift in the 11, trying to get by the 44 of Frank Kimmel, but it's Austin Wayne Self that makes his way by the 11 of Matt Tift and moves up to third. And here comes Austin Wayne Self trying to take second away from Kimmel now as they come out of four.
I think right now, Rick, I think all these guys are on equal tires right now. I think they all have one set of tires left. Remember, around lap 60 is when the majority of the field put tires on. Then it was around lap 100, 110, something like that, when Justin Boston and the four put tires on. And now I think they're all on equal tires. For Brandon Jones right now is on the move.
Jim Tredo.
One thing to look at is how Frank Kimmel is rotating through the center of the corner. He did come down and change four tires on the 44 Ansel Menard Ford. He said the car was a bit tight in the middle. They made an air pressure adjustment. That's all they did, added a bit of fuel to get that rear weight back in that car. And here he goes now with a challenge by the 22. But Kimmel's car working a lot better in the center with that adjustment and the pit stop.
You know, it was 2012 when Frank Kimmel found victory lane here at Lucas Oil Raceway, and it was a 75-race winless streak that he was on.
It's hard to believe that a guy that won 80 races could have that long a winless streak, but Frank Kimmel did it in fashion last year, too, winning what, three or four races and the championship.
And right now he's got his hands full. The 22 of Austin Wayne Self is working the inside right now, Wendy.
And that is for the second position. Austin Wayne Self came down pit road at lap 159. He has been tight in the center, took four tires and fuel. Austin told me this afternoon before the race that he wasn't the fastest car, but he felt like he was the most consistent car. And that consistency has paid off for Austin Wayne Self as he finds himself in the second position with 27 laps to go.
The laps winding down, the 22 of Austin Wayne Self looking very strong. Take a look at how he took these positions away.
Matt Tift, the 11 right in front of him. He makes contact with the 44 at Frank Kimmel, and Austin Wayne Self is going to take advantage.
Gets by the 11, also uses that inside line to get by the 44. Austin Wayne Self up into the second spot. Here's Grant Infinger, four wins on the season, looking to take a position away from Matt Tift. That's the fight for the fourth position.
We saw Tom Hessert restart up towards the front. Tom Hessert, I think, is the only guy that didn't have any tires left. He stopped on lap 60 and lap 100, put tires on. And right now he finds himself falling back in the 10th spot.
So the guy out front, Brandon Jones, has made one other start in the ARCA Racing Series. That happened at Winchester two races ago. And in that start, he went to victory lane. He's trying to make his record remain perfect if he can get back to victory lane. There's the gap between one and two as we have less than 24 laps to go from Lucas Oil Raceway in the ARCA Racing Series. Coming up next, get in the ring as Fox Fight Night returns with a full card of epic bouts, including a showdown between undefeated junior welterweight Frankie Gomez and Vernon Parris. Coverage begins next on Fox Sports 1 and streaming live on Fox Sports Go. Great battles here, short track battles from Lucas Oil Raceway as Brandon Jones tries to stay perfect in his two ARCA Racing Series starts. He is out front of Austin Wayne Self by 1.2 seconds with just 16 laps to go.
Austin Wayne Self had closed up to within about a half a second. Now Brandon Jones has been able to open that back up over a second. And this battle continues for the fourth spot right here with Matt Tiffin, the 11, and the 90 of Grant Enfinger, with John West Holly, the 15, right there as well.
This is reminiscent of one of the restarts where Grant Enfinger and Matt Tiff were actually racing for the lead, and a little looks like contact there between Grant Enfinger and the 15 of John West Holly.
Yeah, John West Holly was going to use the outside of the racetrack with, because Grant Enfinger was on the inside trying to get by Matt Tiff, and Grant came up the racetrack a little bit and squeezed John West.
Bobby Gerhart, lap down car, run very high, turns one and two as the fight for that fourth position continues between Matt Tift and Grant Enfinger. The championship battle really heats up now because championship leader Mason Mitchell is still behind the wall in the infield. He's going to end up in the 20th spot tonight. He will not be able to improve on 20th, and he won't fall back any further than 20th. So Mason Mitchell, not the night that he was looking for, especially after so many consecutive top tens.
Yeah, Grant Enfinger right now is in the driver's seat to take over this point lead as long as he stays on the racetrack and finishes somewhere around the top five. Right, meanwhile, Brandon Jones, as you mentioned, trying to be perfect, trying to go two for two in his ARCA racing career.
Good man out of Atlanta, Georgia, was able to get to victory lane. In Winchester two races ago, earlier in qualifying, he broke the track record and has been very impressive tonight. Back in the second place, Austin Wayne Self, the 22, that 18-year-old out of Austin, Texas, has had a second place finish at Winchester back in 2013, but has yet to find victory lane.
May find himself in the same situation that Mason Mitchell did for so long. Right now, a great car has a couple second lead over that third place car right there, Frank Kimmel. Frank doing a nice job here. Really made that car better. We talk about the fact that he has a new crew chief over there. Mark Rett now is calling the shots for the 44 car, and they have a pretty good run going here.
Pretty impressive short track racing for Frank Kimmel. Back there in the fourth position, Grant Enfinger in the number 90. Four wins already to start off the 2014 season. And as you mentioned, now in the driver's seat for the championship once again because of the problems.
Finally able to get by that 11 of Matt Tiff. They've been racing, it seems like, since the last restart. That's another 5 points for Grant Enfinger.
Clicking off. Still many laps, and we only have eight to go now.
This is that battle right here for the fourth spot. A little bit of contact. Grant Enfinger's going to get in the back of Matt Tiff and use that little contact to get by him.
So that's the way Enfinger got up into the fourth spot. Matt Tiff back there in the fifth position. Tiff also another 18-year-old out of Hinckley, Ohio. His last run out was a third-place finish at Chicagoland. That's the third time he has finished in the third position. And we look back at Kenny Schrader running in the seventh position now.
Justin Boston, such a horrible break for Justin Boston. Had this race in hand. Bobby Gerhart spun. Now, maybe with that caution coming out, maybe he wouldn't have won this race. He had the dominant car at the time, but such a tough break. Had radio trouble, did not realize that Bobby Gerhart was sitting down there in the racetrack, drove in the corner like he normally would, as hard as he normally would, and all of a sudden, there's Bobby Gerhart sitting in front of him.
And timing didn't work out also in the sense that he had just entered turn number one when the caution light, which is just outside of turn number one, came on. And so it might not have been in his peripheral vision. So he was still going, as you mentioned earlier, very hard into turns one and two. And he couldn't really lock up the brakes. He didn't also hear that the caution had come out. So an unfortunate incident for that 25 team.
Yeah, that's one thing that young man will never forget. He's going to realize that this one potentially got away from him. You know, not necessarily his fault. He had radio trouble, didn't really see what was going on, but a tough break nonetheless. But Justin Allison right now running up with another top 10 run in the ninth spot, doing a super job this year. Very, very consistent. You see both left side brake rotors glowing for that 88 car, but he's hanging in there right now in the ninth spot.
If he can hang on, this would be his fifth top 10 finish in 2014. And just behind him, it's Tommy Hesser in the 77. Another one of the cars that came onto pit road on lap 104, so had a little bit fresher tires, but wasn't really able to take advantage of that.
Yeah, well, he moved it up into the top three, and the problem was that was his, he put his second set of tires on that caution flag right after halfway. So when the caution flag came out, when Bobby Gearhart and Justin Boston got together, Tom didn't have any tires left. So right now, he's running, the 88, Justin Allison, we were just talking about him. Three laps to go, he's made some pretty significant contact with the outside wall here.
One of the things, if he could keep up pace, which right now it doesn't look like he's going to, he's going to try to get to pit road. We have just over two laps to go. When we come out of turn four, Brandon Jones is going to see the white flag. White flag in the air one more time around for Brandon Jones.
He doesn't need to take any chances with this traffic. Now he's opened up over a four-second lead over the second-place car, Boston Wayne Self.
What an impressive start to his ARCA Racing Series career. As Brandon Jones works through three and four, he's going to remain perfect. His last start, he went to victory lane. That was also his first. This is his second start. He'll win again in the ARCA Racing Series.
Look at this battle coming off the corner for second. Looks like Austin Wayne Self just narrowly stayed ahead of that 44 car, Frank Kimmel.
Kenny Schrader is going to come home in the seventh spot. Justin Boston will end up in the eighth position. The last driver to win his first two starts in the ARCA Racing Series was Alex Bowman. And oh, by the way, I believe you will be calling qualifying tomorrow for the Brickyard 400. And Alex Bowman will be trying to qualify for his first Brickyard 400 tomorrow. An impressive run for Brandon Jones.
Brandon's getting so much experience this year running the Truck Series, running some K&N races, and doing a whale of a job here in the ARCA Racing Series.
And how about this? Just his second celebration for wins, but he's able to figure it out.
Yeah, he had that figured out pretty well.
Great burnout for Brandon Jones, getting career win number two in his second start. The ninth different Lucas Oil Raceway winner in the ARCA Racing Series.
I think his car is in there somewhere. There it is.
Car and driver. Becomes just the second multiple winner in 2014. Let's hear from the winning crew chief standing by with Wendy.
And I'm with Shane Huffman, the winning crew chief here. Now, I know you had to make a call early in that stage to stay out when everyone else decided to come down and get fresh tires. How difficult was that part of the race for you?
Well, I thought it was going to be okay there until I got to about lap 100.
Oh, my God! Woo!
How did that feel?
Well, it wasn't that hot out, trust me. these guys over here, this is honestly a total Turner Scott Motorsports team effort. Shannon Rush, the crew chief on the 31 Nationwide car, set this thing up for us. I never saw it till we got here today, honestly. So I tell you what, Brandon Jones has become a hell of a little race car driver, and I'm proud he got this one, and I'm proud of the way he got it too. We beat him pretty good there, and I like that.
All right, congratulations, and I'm sure he's gonna go warm up after that nice ice bath. But the last time a driver went back-to-back in his first two wins in the ARCA Series was driver Alex Bowman, and happened back in 2011, guys.
Take a look at her point standings, the unofficial point standings. Grant Enfinger now moves in front of Mason Mitchell, who had the rear-end gear going out on that number 98 car. They had to bring it behind the wall, and that lost that top spot. An impressive run for second-place Austin Wayne Self, who's currently seventh in the point standings and standing by with Jim.
and certainly some great gains by this team. I know you had some fast cars as of late, some bad luck, but tonight has to feel really good finishing second here tonight, Austin.
Yeah, tonight feels really good. You know, I thought for a minute there we were going to get that win, but, I mean, I can't complain with the second place finish. The way things been, I got to thank Cunningham Motorsports for giving me a car I could race with and be able to drive the wheels off it. So, you know, at the beginning of the race, you know, I just told him to be calm. You know, I think we had a good car at the end of the race. In long runs, we showed we had pretty strong car there. We timed it up at the end, and the AM Cunningham Dodge was amazing. So I got to thank Chad Bryant, all these guys on 22 car, Briggs Cunningham, all these guys.
That's Austin Wayne Self tying his career best that he had in Winchester last year. Another short track, another great run for the 22 team. Guys?
Yeah, 17 years old for Brandon Jones, who's in victory lane. Austin Wayne Self, he's just 18 years old. And then if you combine those two ages, you get to who finished in third. Actually, not quite.
You don't quite get there.
52 for Frank Kimmel, who finished up in the third spot. But let's hear from our race winner. He's in victory lane.
2 for 2 for young Brandon Jones. His first win came at Winchester, and he's following it up with a win at Lucas Oil Raceway. Brandon Jones told me his biggest concern. I bet that felt good, Brandon. You told me before the start of this race, your biggest concern was saving tires. Was that your biggest battle?
Not really. I mean, we actually did a really good job with that. I felt the whole race, we were able to maintain great and stay with them all and actually pull away a little bit. Actually, a little bit of a struggle to save, I thought, you know. So I got to thank all these guys at Turner Scott Motorsports and Exide. You know, they killed us on, you know, killed them on pit road and everything. So awesome effort for these guys and pretty cool for 2 for 2.
Now, Turner Scott Motorsports, this is your second race for them in the ARCA Series. Tell the fans at home what you have planned.
Yeah, definitely. You know, we've got one more coming at Kentucky, you know, so looking forward to getting to do that and hopefully we can collect another one.
All right, Brandon Jones in victory lane here at Lucas Oil Raceway. Jim Trado.
With third place finisher Frank Kimmel, he talked to me before the race about how pivotal it is to win here, but you guys made a change. You decided, you know what, we need to change things up here a little bit. Crew Chief Jamie Jones started the season, but there was a crew decision. Let's do something a bit different. Let's get someone else involved in here, Frank. How was your run to third tonight with a new crew chief, Mark Rett?
Well, it was great. It's great to be competitive. You know, we really struggled this year, and we've had some hard times. But, you know, I got to thank Jamie Jones. He did a great job all year for me. And, you know, I really think the world of him, a great guy. But, you know, Mark Rett jumped in on his deal, took the same crew, worked his ass off in his race car. And all day long, they worked hard, and you know, they never gave up. And what a night deal to come up here and challenge for you know, top five, and we haven't done that in a while, so it was nice to get there finally.
Third place for Frank Kimmel tonight, back in championship points contention with Uncle Paul.
All smiles for Frank Kimmel coming home in the third spot, but how about 2 for 2 for this young man, just 17 years old, Brandon Jones. Gets a track record earlier today, gets his second career win in just his second start.
Yeah, and takes Turner Scott to victory lane once again. And I want to say one thing. After 12 years working with you, Rick, it's been a blast, buddy.
Well, it's been amazing, and it will be very difficult to not be at the racetrack with you guys when you go to call the next races. But I've appreciated every single moment of it. Fox Fight Night is coming up next. We didn't really have any punching here at Lucas Oil Raceway. There was a couple bumps and bruises that the cars took, but in the end, it was 17-year-old Brandon Jones who claims his second win in the ARCA Racing Series, just the third winner from the pole in 2014. Congratulations.